Welcome. I'm glad you're with us. These are scary times, times of anxiety and fear. And so in these times, it's good to come before God's presence and to worship. It's good to allow the music to move our spirits. It's good to pray the prayers and sing the hymns and hear God's word proclaimed. It's good for us to be in the presence of the Almighty. And so I pray in these moments that God will flood your spirit with his spirit. Let us worship our great God. Call to worship comes from 1 Peter. In his great mercy, he has given to us an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for us.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in deepest sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright, who will bear you calling in the night. the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
If you're joining us on the FPC Events website, please join with me in the unison prayer. Hear us, Lord. All that we have is yours, and all the gifts that we use to serve you belong to you. Yet you serve us more than we serve you. Heaven and earth, which you created for your use, stand before you. And each day they carry out your every command. But we, Lord, fail to live the life we so desire to live. Forgive us, mold us, and change us, that we might become your lights in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Songs of praises I will ever give to thee. Songs of praises I will sing to thee.
In high school, Richard Paul Evans, the author of the novel The Locket, was assigned to visit a woman in a nursing home. She was old and very sad. She sat by the window day after day, just staring out into space. Try as he might to stir up a conversation, she would maybe nod or just ignore him. He began to wonder what created this sadness in her. What was her life story? And in his imagination, he created a story, her storyline, that eventually became a novel, The Locket. And in the novel and in his story, Esther is in a nursing home. Michael comes to work at the nursing home. Esther is filled with sadness and loneliness. She stares out at the window. Her and Michael begin a friendship, and a conversation develops over time. She shares with Michael her story. As a young woman, her mother died, and her her father operated a boarding house. Her first husband was abusive to her, to her husband, to her father, and to her children. And then along came Thomas, a resident in the boarding house. Thomas was different. Thomas was persistent, and a friendship developed, but Esther was really emotionally scarred. Their friendship developed into a love relationship. She loved Thomas, but couldn't commit to him. He received a draft notice for the war, and on the night before he was to report, he gave her a locket that said, "Forever Thomas." He offered her a ring, a marriage proposal, but she declined. Thomas left that night rejected, never to return. But Esther never forgot. She kept that locket. That was her pride possession over the years. She had hoped that someday, some way, she'd get a second chance. She was now in the nursing home, and in that nursing home, she would check the obituaries every day, hoping to find Thomas's wife's name. And one day it appears. A few days after the funeral, she has Michael drive her to Thomas's house. Thomas's daughter escorts Esther into the house and into Thomas's room. And there he sits by the side of the bed, deep in the throngs of dementia. He does not recognize Esther. It's too late. She'll never get a second chance. John, the disciple, the beloved disciple, had that same kind of fear that those who would come after him might not believe. They might not accept Jesus' invitation to follow, the proposal to believe. And so he writes his gospel. He sits down and writes his stories of his time with Jesus. And he writes it so that others might believe, so others would accept the invitation. John writes in the first chapter of his gospel, he says, "The Word became flesh and lived among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, children who were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but born of God." John writes, "We have seen his glory." Jesus came into this world, but the world passed him by, did not recognize him, did not accept the invitation to follow, the proposal to believe. But to all who do, and to all who did, he gives the gift of God's love, to become children of God, redeemed children of God. God's invitation to all of us is simple. It's not profound, it's not difficult, it's a simple invitation to follow. The invitation was given to Andrew and to Peter, to James and to John, to Levi the tax collector, to the sinful woman, it was, come, follow me. Peppered throughout the Gospels is that simple yet profound invitation to follow. It's important to Jesus that people follow him, that people accept the invitation. In these uncertain times, when the future is unknown, the call is the same. Follow me. Follow me into the darkness. Follow me into the unknown. Follow me, and I will give you peace. For the one who holds the future is the one we follow. Let us pray. Father, we come before your powerful throne of grace, and there is fear and worry all around us. These are scary times. These are times in which people die. We'd ask, O Lord God, that you might give us a sense of peace. We lift before your throne of grace those that we know and those that we love that need your healing hand. We ask for wisdom and guidance for all people, everywhere. We come before that powerful throne of grace. And as your people, you've invited us to pray the prayer you gave us. So hear us as we pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh,